Good morning. This is Alchemical Connections with Chrissy McMahon. And I'd like to give a big shout out to Muddy Muddy Mud Man for this awesome intro that you can't hear. But just wanted to let everybody know that we will be listening to our guest, Andrew Norton. Say good morning again. We have my wonderful guest, Andrew Norton Weber, is with me now. I'm trying to find his intro. Andrew Norton Weber is a proponent and researcher of distilled water and urine therapy for over 10 years, an invited speaker at the upcoming 6th World Congress on Urotherapy in San Diego, California, November 14th to the 16th, 2013. And Andrew has been interviewed on numerous alternative media internet radio programs and is currently working on an ambitious 8-volume encyclopedic compilation of his research, starting with Distilled Waters, his forthcoming book, and numerous distilled liquid social media pages and the website AquariusTheWaterBearer.com. And I'd like to say good afternoon to Angel. I don't know if you remember Dave Matthews. Dave Matthews, listen to me. Dave Murphy. Do you remember Dave Murphy from England?
How could I forget?
Yeah, that's his mom.
Oh, cool.
And she's a big, big proponent of distilled waters, so maybe she'll have some encouraging words to share with us.
Wow, excellent. Yes, I remember he gave quite a testimonial, and that was quite a while ago. I mean, she's with us, and we'll get to hear what she has to say.
I'm not sure she'll have much to say. She's okay. More of a listener, but
okay.
She when you ask her, she'll give you the skinny on.
Okay.
On distilled liquids, absolutely. And she'll be proud to know that this morning I soaked my feet in my own waters, and they feel wonderful. It worked very well. So I'm very happy that she gave me that advice. And Andrew, how are you? I missed you. Welcome back.
I'm doing great. I took a little break there. Got a lot of organization and archiving done. Had two wonderful friends helping me do that, and we're still doing it. Trying to get the testimonials volume completed before the 2 November conferences. I will be speaking at the World Urine Congress, and that website is worldcongressurotherapy.org. That's November 16th, and the very next Saturday, November 23rd, will be the Distilled Waters Conference in Sacramento, and that website is distilledwatersconference.com. There's also distilledwatersconferencesacramento.com. But that's put on, being organized by Dr. Cheryl Scott and her wonderful husband, Bill O'Hara, who you interviewed once. My other website is andrewnortonweber.com, and we've got also a new, I spent a lot more time researching into doctors. The original 24 doctors list that I made, I put together in about 3 hours, and those were all the ones that were easy to find, because I was trying to encourage my family who didn't want to listen to somebody that's not doesn't have a college degree. So I said, okay, well, I'll put together quotes from people who've been to college. But during this break I've taken, I spent a lot more time digging and going further into the past. I found a lot more quotes from the 1800s. And so now the doctors, and it's called doctors and experts. I stopped trying to count the numbers. It's up around 75 people, though. And we got Nikola Tesla in there now, and Edgar Cayce, and Aristotle. And I found really a heartwarming world of knowledge from the 1800s. Just amazing. And one of the doctors I found was Dr. Russell Trall, T-R-A-L-L. And believe it or not, I can't believe this. I haven't even dove into it yet. There used to be this knowledge, this water knowledge, was everywhere at one time. So much so that there was a movement known as the hygienists. And of course, they were into practicing health through cleanliness, which is what water does. It cleans the body. And there was a certain type of doctor that I guess I would be, and anybody else who uses the water cure, as what was a, that was a commonly known term back then, was the water cure. But that certain type of doctor was called a hydropath, and they had hydropathy. A water doctor. And that was a common term. And Russell Trall wrote an encyclopedia. And it's called the Hydropathic Encyclopedia. It's printed in the 1850s. And it comes in two volumes. And I haven't even started into it yet. But I found a used copy for $1. You can get digital reprints for $16 to $20. But I'm just floored. I haven't even, it was like, oh my gosh, there's an entire encyclopedia about the water cure. Crazy. And
what's the gentleman's name again? Trall.
Russell. Yeah, Dr. Russell Trall, T-R-A-L-L. And I've got some quotes from him in my new Doctors and Experts document, and that can be found at both the Aquarius, the waterbearer.com site, and also AndrewNortonWeber.com.
Okay, and what was, you were promoting, was it just the testimonials that you have, or the thing that you were saying on Vinnie Eastwood's show about that people should read it? Was it the testimonials?
I was probably referring to the Doctors and Experts link at either one of my websites. But also now, we have a book in progress, which one volume of the bigger work that we're working on, but it's the testimonials. It looks like when we're done, we're going to have over 2,000 testimonials. And the main gist of this is to have them listed alphabetically by disease or issue so that people can look up what they're experiencing and see what others before them have experienced using the water cure, the distilled waters. And on both of my websites, there's now a PDF link that has over 500 testimonials in it, but they're mainly urine therapy testimonials. That was just one section. I haven't even finished pulling out all the testimonials out of my urine therapy books, but right now there is one document there underneath the link testimonials that's got 500 urine therapy ones. And I think by the time we're done, we're going to split it so that, you know, because not everybody's going to want to, if you're trying to get this to this knowledge out to your aunt or your uncle who doesn't want to hear about urine, we're going to split. There'll be a master testimonial list, which you give to anybody, but I think we'll also have a list that's just a distilled waters testimonial, and we'll have it split into also one that's just the urine testimonials.
That's amazing. I mean, the work you've accomplished in the last year is just phenomenal. And the interviews that you've done, the radio shows, all the work you've done to promote this and to find out there are other people There's lots of new friends, I'm sure, who are also and have been doing it almost as long as you have.
Yep.
In different capacities around the world. It's just amazing, the connections. It's just awesome.
Thank you. Yeah, it's really exciting. Oh, thanks, Chrissy. And it's been great to have you as a champion all along. And you got that original co-creating God interview that we did. It's almost up to 20,000 views now.
Wow.
And here we go again. I'd like to read for you a quote from Dr. Russell Trull from an address he delivered at the Smithsonian Institute in Washington, D.C. in 1862. The speech was called The True Healing Art, or Hygienic versus Drug Medication. Have you ever heard of a sanative? You know what that is?
No, sanative, no.
A sanative is something that has the power to cure or heal or restore. Something that is conducive to physical or spiritual health and well-being. So Dr. Russell Trull, this great quote, he talks about this thing called the matchless sanative. Something that has the power to heal, but is matchless. So here's the quote. And the matchless sanative, who has not known of its marvelous cures? 25 or 30 years ago, it was all the rage in some places. I have seen many chronic invalids who had worn out half a dozen regular physicians and swallowed the whole round of patent nostrums. But nothing ever did them so much good as the matchless sanative. Well, it was a matchless medicine. It was the very best remedy, as a universal panacea ever sold to an afflicted mortal at an extravagant price. For it was pure water and nothing else.
Wow.
Now that is a statement coming from the guy who has written the Hydropathic Encyclopedia, which I haven't even dug into yet.
Is the whole thing available online, or you bought a copy?
Yeah, I don't think it's available online. I need an army of secretaries to take these books and turn them into PDFs. I will do that. And I'm going to read you one more thing from him, and it's a poem. And it's only four lines, but the implications of what he's stating in it are as advanced a thing as you and I have ever talked about. Seriously. And this was from 1863, from something called The Month, a column in the Herald of Health, which was published in New York. And the poem, of course, is called Water. To the days of the aged, it addeth length. To the might of the strong, it addeth strength. It freshens the heart, it brightens the sight. 'Tis like quaffing a goblet of morning light. So, right there, I mean, I think one of the highest things I can say about water is that when you know, that water is a conduit for pure light, and when you are pure, when your body does not have much dirt in it, you channel more light. And when your body is dirtier, people get gray and they channel less light. And right here, when he says, 'tis like quaffing a goblet of morning light, he's saying that water is like drinking light. And that's right on. That was 1863. Amazing.
Yep.
And one more quote from him. It's just great. He says, if children were properly educated, or rather, if medical men had not miseducated the world, every ABC school, boy and girl, would have known that pure air and pure water are the best. So, those are three pretty awesome quotes. And none of those are even out of the Hydropathic Encyclopedia. Those are just speeches and essays he was giving.
Amazing.
So we got that going for us. And something else we got here is a modern-day doctor, and he doesn't mention distilled water or urine at all, and his name is Dr. Sidney Baker. And there's a couple of books, but the one I'm holding now is called Detoxification and Healing, The Key to Optimum Health. And he's got a picture of a pitcher of water being poured into a glass. And I'd like to talk about detox, because that's what this guy is really good about. And he has finally put a scientific doctor's stamp on what I was noticing and feeling already, and putting into my own layman's terms, which is that detoxification is the most expensive process that the body goes through. And we have these detox symptoms that people are experiencing. And I'm noticing that the detox symptoms people are experiencing now are not matched in all of the books. We've been being sprayed with chemtrails for about 15, almost 20 years now. Mm-hmm. And most of these books... Yeah, well...
They have pictures of the National Geographic from the early 80s that have chemtrails in them.
Okay, gotcha. But of course, most of my urine therapy books and most of my distilled waters books were all written before that. And the detox symptoms that people are having now are a lot more severe, or they can be. For the average person, what Dr. Sidney Baker put it, I'll just say this, he said that there is a pairing up. And that's the key word. That when you detox, each individual toxin needs to be escorted out of the body by one of your organic mineral stores. And this is finally answering the last ruse that I couldn't quite give an answer to, except that they were just lying, in the Mercola, the early death article. And that was, they referred to these, whoever the article that the author was referring to, done many tests over his lifetime and over 3,000 case studies, something like that. You notice that after people drinking distilled water had depleted minerals. And it's obvious from science and opposite the track that distilled water cannot magnetically attach to any of your organic minerals that are supposed to be in your body. It only attaches to those that are negatively charged, positively charged. And this pairing up, this is what is causing some people to get low minerals when they first start hitting the pure waters. But we notice that it never happens to a relatively healthy person or somebody who has already done a lot of the cleaning out work. Everybody noticed that when they first try fasting, it's harder, it's the hardest in the beginning, and you get hit with the heaviest detox symptoms. And as you stay on the distilled waters, the detox symptoms get less and less. So what's going on there? Why is it that in the beginning, when you hit the distilled waters, you can get a whole variety of different uncomfortable feelings. Doctor, this is a great book, Detoxification and Healing. This guy explains it very well, that all toxins have to be paired up with an escort. They can't just, he talked about, for instance, ammonia cannot just be allowed to free roam the blood system. And also we know that when you drink soda, that it literally leaches calcium out of the bones. And that's because your body has to use up its actual stores of organic minerals to pair up with these toxins. Mm-hmm. And so this is what is causing mineral depletion. And this is why you can study, 3,000 patients who go on distilled water and see them having low electrolytes. But that only happens in the beginning. That only happens because the toxins that you have in you right now that are quote-unquote safely tucked away have never been paired up with your toxins. And because the body tucks things away that it doesn't have time to process. It only will process things properly. It won't eject toxins unless it can do it with the proper water and proper escorts, the pairing up. So if you're consuming more garbage than the speed, and it's excelling the speed at which your body can eject garbage, your body tucks it away in places that aren't vital to you, like along the sides of your bones, in between your bones, along the pathways of your veins, causing plaque, along the sides of the colon, like a compacted matter. And so when you finally do start giving your body the proper water flow to move these things out, it starts to say, okay, well, we're gonna deal with this piece of, say, phosphoric acid or carbonic acid. I don't know if it's both or one of those. It's in soda. But whatever. Okay, now we need to pair up. We need to steal a piece of calcium from your bones to match it up with this piece of soda garbage that we didn't have time to process or the capacity to process 5.5 years ago when you drank that particular Coke with those literal toxins in it. So people are carrying around decades-old garbage. And when they first start hitting the pure waters, now they actually have to deal with things that they ate 5, 10, 15, 20 years ago. And this guy, Dr. Sidney Baker, puts it very well by saying that it's the most expensive process, the immune system and the detoxification. And there is a pairing up, and that explains, so it's not the water that's sticking to and leaching minerals, it's the very things that you put in your mouth that you never should have. And in general, we're finding, and it's what will make obvious sense to relate to that, is juicing mitigates detox symptoms. And so, in John Armstrong's books, in all the urine therapy books, there's almost no talk of juicing. And people could just start pounding their urine with no, they would have the detox symptoms, but they would just go through it and could make it through. But sometimes, so I tell people that they control the speed of the detox. If it's too much detox, if you feel too bad, if you feel weak, if you feel your heart feel weird, you can control the speed of it. So back off on the distilled waters and or jump increase the intake of juices, because what that'll do, especially during the early stages of detox, will provide you those organic minerals that you need to pair up with your ancient toxins. And it'll help you not feel so bad in the beginnings of detox. And, of course, we find that the movie Fat, Sick, and Nearly Dead You have two very sick men. One 400 pounds, one 300 pounds, almost 300 pounds. And what I'm noticing in that movie is that they have very few detox symptoms. And they were choosing juices, one of the four distilled waters. And it's that massive amounts of nutrients coming in with the juices to pair up with all their ancient toxins that even though they're extremely loaded with toxins, I mean, that 400-pound trucker, he had relatively few detox symptoms compared to what I see in the urine therapy world or the just distilled water world. And so I think just a general rule of thumb would be that in general, for any detox symptoms you're feeling, that drinking juices will help to mitigate those and flush them out faster and not steal from your body's reserves.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So yeah,
that's what basically. I do. I do a combination of.
Mm-hmm.
I don't drink urine as often as I should, but I've been drinking distilled water, my own I make, since we met. So I've been drinking that religiously, but I haven't been drinking it at the recommended levels, and I think that's the most detrimental to my health. Because I do tend to have the idea in the back of my head that if I'm drinking the distilled water, it'll counteract the ill effects of the food that I'm consuming. And it's not working as fast as. And my sister's the one who pointed it out to me, and I noticed there was something going on there. But, yeah, I have a lot of work to do, and I've been very neglectful of taking care of my body, and about 2 months ago I was given a diagnosis of pre-diabetic, and I know exactly why, because I was working 16-hour shifts coming home and eating Haagen-Dazs. So you do that for like months on end, you know, something's gonna, you know, happen physically. So I haven't been eating properly, and I haven't been drinking water at the 1 gallon a day, per day or more. So I have a lot of catching up to do, a lot of things have happened to me since in the last 6 months that have been totally amazing and totally unbelievable. I became homeless. And my sister invited me to come and stay at her house. She lives in the mountains. And it's absolutely beautiful here. And I have this opportunity to just relax and catch up with myself. And I went right into my old way of doing things and had to go out and get a job. And been working like a fool for very little money. But I've also been helping my family. So it's been like, you know, catch 22. I've been realizing how much I can trust my intuition, but at the same time not heeding all the valuable knowledge that I have gained over the last few years. So you know, I applaud you for taking off the time and just saying no and delving into your work and organizing and doing what you're doing, because that's the only way you get things done. You can't do what I'm doing and expect to, you know, accomplish much. So
I'm very grateful to have my wife Susie being the breadwinner for us. And she, again, she's the one that's paid for all of the research materials. Every single dime that's been spent to pull us together has been out of her pocket and from the sale of her paintings.
which are amazing, by the way. Yeah.
Yeah, those can be seen at SusieScarborough.com. Susie spelled S-U-Z-Y. Scarborough, like the fair. But also, I've had to do a lot of art shows, and that requires many. I've probably driven close to 1,000,000 miles now over the past 10 years in between doing this research. I drove back and forth to New York City 3 weekends in a row, 2,000 miles per weekend. It's been wonderful to have the time in between shows and to have all these resource materials and great friends who have been helping me to put this work together. So we're getting there.
That is amazing. And Angel, Dave's mother, has made a comment. She says, I've been on distilled water for the past year. I used to drink 100% juice from the shops, but now my body does not like this because it makes me feel ill. Now I juice instead, and it is better, and I'm better. And she says, what is the recommended levels? And she says, I drink 1 gallon in 2 days, cannot manage one in a day. I feel uncomfortable to do it.
Well, the gallon is for an average 150-pound man, and that's total combined of all the four distilled waters together. She's probably 100 pounds, I don't know. Maybe 3/4 a gallon for her.
But she drinks juices, fresh squeezed juices, and she also, if she doesn't mind me saying, she also drinks her own water. So she may
right.
be getting
so whatever
one
the,
gallon.
Yeah, okay, if she's not including the total volume. Yeah.
Yeah, so she's an amazing mentor and example.
And so she was drinking pasteurized juices. That's what she means, 100%. The quote-unquote 100% juices from the store, they may be 100% juice, but once they're pasteurized, they've had all life force removed, and thus they become deadly.
Yes. And she says, yes, I do.
Thank you,
no,
Angel.
No, I was not. I'm not sure. No, I was not drinking the... I think she meant they were 100% juice, that some stores like Whole Foods and different places like that.
Uh-huh.
My mother has a store in Florida and in Sarasota that's comparable to Whole Foods. I forget what it's called, but she loves that store, and they do make their own fresh squeezed juices. So
mm-hmm. Okay.
It's possible she was drinking something from the store. Oh, she's not including urine therapy.
Uh-huh. She probably is up to the gallon.
Okay. And Welsh Key, we have a Welsh Key here explaining, try and do a liter and a half a morning quick because becomes easy, then Andrew showed me. Yes, Andrew showed a lot of us. We're very fortunate, yeah.
Well, we're finding, though, once people get past the major hump of detox symptoms, that's how the breatharians come into play and helps to understand that the body will actually produce its own raw materials once you can get it clean enough. All matter is condensed light, and the human body is a light harvesting tool. And Cohen van der Kroon, who wrote The Golden Fountain, also wrote a great essay called Transmutation Theory, talking about the body's ability, basically how to the body's ability to condense light into whatever materials it needs. And this would explain how people during a 40-day urine fast can start growing new hair and repair their skin and repair their bones. They're not taking in any raw materials. They're not even juicing. So how is it that it's happening? Where is the raw material coming from to provide new pigment for the hair cells, to rebuild the eyes, the bones, the heart, the skin? And so it looks like if once you get clean enough, you actually can walk free of the need to consume dense matter and fully operate properly in your light body, and just be a pure light channeler. But it takes a while to get there, and I want to talk more about how people are sicker than ever. It's because, and that's why the detox symptoms seem to be more severe now than anything that I have in my books to refer to, because we are in such a toxic environment. The chemtrails and the fluoride is just everywhere now. And also something that is giving, you know, potassium is what your heart needs. And so there are people having irregular heartbeats with early detox symptoms. It's not just that people have to detox ancient cooked food anymore. They've also got to detox the constant intake of the chemtrail ingredients. And on potassium specifically, it looks like there is a potassium conspiracy or an attempt to limit the amount of potassium that humans can get. And there's three different assaults that I see going on potassium. And that is one, that in the drug stores, in the health food stores, it is the only pill, substance, mineral that I'm aware of that is limited in the amount that you can get in each pill. You know, like vitamin A and C, you can get 5,000% of your USRDA in one pill, your recommended daily allowance. Or a lot of things, you can at least get 100%, you know. But potassium, you can only get pills that contain up to 3% of your recommended daily allowance of potassium, no matter what supplements you look into. And so you'd have to take 33 of those pills to get 100% of your recommended daily amount of potassium. So they're limiting it that way. Of course, a lot of the foods are depleted, and they don't, definitely the conventional foods don't have as many minerals in them, but that's not as strong as the other two that I'm going to mention, things that are limiting potassium, which is that with HARP and the electronic warfare, I've seen papers talking about broadcasting of signals that knock potassium out of the body. I don't know if they are broadcasting the actual the wave frequency of potassium or the reverse of it, and it knocks out of the body. Something like that. There's a potential for the way HARP works and scalar weapons that it's neutralizing potassium, and you know, it's being done on purpose. It seems like there's an all-out effort to limit people's capacity to get potassium, which affects your heart, which affects your overall strength. And the worst, most obvious assault on potassium is the barium in the chemtrail spray. That is a known scientific fact. I was talking about pairing up earlier, that your body has to pair up. Mm-hmm. When you ingest barium, the resource from your body's stores of organic minerals that it takes is potassium. Barium knocks potassium out of the body. And I remember I was talking to a urine therapy author once. I don't want to mention their name, because it was kind of a sad sight. This author was aware of the potassium conspiracy, but had taken it upon themselves to deal with it by consuming no salt, a product you can find on the stores, which is full of, it's a salt substitute, and the substitute is potassium chloride, which is the inorganic version. It's not living potassium like you would find in carrots and celery and parsnips. It's a dead potassium, but he was constantly taking teaspoonfuls of this no salt in his water, and he didn't know about distilled water either. But he looked awful. He looked kind of bloated, and I had seen videos of him before giving talks, and he looked like a beautiful urine therapy practitioner. He looked very healthy, but now he was kind of grayish and aged and very bloated skin, and I didn't say anything, but I was like, man, that's just not working for you. But now I understand what he was doing was he was aware of the potassium conspiracy, but his solution was to take poisonous potassium. And there's a much better solution, which is to take living potassium, which can be found in fruits and vegetables. And which brings me around to a wonderful recipe for potassium from Dr. Norman Walker, one of our distilled water doctors who's on the list of awesome quotes. But he wrote a great book called Fresh Vegetable and Fruit Juices, and there's a link to a PDF of that on my website. And in there, he had a recipe, it's called raw potassium broth. And broth makes you think of a cooked soup, but it's not. He meant to have it raw. And I can't remember the four, but they were three. It was carrots, celery, I think parsnips, and another kind of vegetable like that. They each had their own variations of organic potassiums. And he said when you put all four of them together, they act like a super potassium. So I found it interesting that he had that recipe. So everybody can look that up. And he basically just juicing four vegetables that all are known to have potassium in them. So I think that's a really great recipe, especially for people that are detoxing. We're finding that the average healthy person can just start hitting the distilled waters without doing too much juicing. They've got kind of their own enough of their own stores to get through the detox, and then they can get clean enough and they can get to a state where they're actually producing their own minerals, and so they can move on to liquidarianism, breatharianism if they want. And even the average unhealthy person can kind of make it through without too much need for additional external minerals. But we are swamped with people that are below what we grew up thinking of as the average unhealthy person. Because of the level of toxicity, people have been consuming more supplements than others, than ever. And those supplements tend to be dead and actually unhealthy. And most supplements work by a very incorrect way that you don't want to happen. They work by poisonous stimulation method. The most simple one that everybody can understand is coffee. People think that the caffeine gives them energy, but it doesn't at all. It actually robs you of energy, of your life force. The caffeine is poisonous, and your body releases adrenaline there's a pairing up. Your precious stores of whatever it takes to make adrenaline, your body has to use adrenaline to counter and to neutralize the poisonous effects of caffeine. And it's your adrenaline that gives you what you think is the energy. You get that stimulated effect. All of a sudden you're like buzzing after you drink coffee. It's not the caffeine. It's the fact that it's poisonous and your body has to jump into emergency detox response, and that's the energy. And so it's drawing from your life force reserves. Whereas the opposite, if you eat some living foods, they actually have life force that they're giving to you, and the energy you get from them is from them, not from your precious bodily reserves. So people, even in trying to make themselves healthier, have actually been making themselves sicker by taking dead supplements. You see athletes consuming those vast amounts of powdered protein drinks, giant jugs of, and they usually mix it with milk, which is deadly. But that's just loaded with chemicals. And again, you know, but they get huge. They become athletes. They can do super things. But a lot of it's because the stuff is poisonous and their body is forced into ramping up and summoning up vast amounts of energy to deal with the daily consumption of poison. And then when they do start detoxing, it hits them hard. So we seem to have people more stoved up than ever with toxins. I mean, it's obvious. We're being sprayed on a daily basis. Even if you're a fruitarian or breatharian, you're still breathing that stuff daily. But once you get the body to even a relatively clean state, it can handle the daily influx. My chemtrail symptoms, kind of like the beginnings of Morgellons, which I had very intense itching on my forearms and the back of my neck, those have all totally disappeared. And so you can get healthy enough that you can handle what's in this daily toxic soup that we're walking around in. I don't want to be, but the body can definitely handle it, and anybody can if they understand the water knowledge and practice it and get enough flow going through them.
Yeah, and we were having a little chat on Awake there about coconut juice, coconut milk, and coconut oil. And Angel was saying that she likes to make her own coconut milk from coconuts, fresh coconuts, and that she heats it up. And I'm not sure what temperature there is, but also, Kevin from London says hello, and I'm calling him Welsh Key, or Welsh Kev. I thought it said Welsh Key, my mistake. I'm still sleeping, and my glasses just don't get the small letters. I'm sorry.
But, Kevin is one of my guardian angels. He escorted me up to, we went to the tour together, and we helped drive home a message to the earth about the remembrance of the water. Giant 6'6" tall Welshman carries quite a bow and arrow with too. He's got some golden arrows out there for helping restore the planet and shoot the moon and all kinds of remedies. So yeah. Hey Kevin. And he's got he himself has his own healing stories, and his dog Sazzy, and so he's been a wonderful example too of a lot of healing. But go on.
That was basically it. Kev mentioned something about radiation, so I guess when you were talking about the chemtrails.
Mm-hmm. Right, we got more.
Says, he says he loves you, bro.
Oh, I love you too, bro. yeah, right. We got that's on top of the chemtrails and the fluoride and the GMOs and the vaccine and on and on and on. We
and
got
not only that, we just found out too that this fracking that they're doing all around the world is bringing up stuff. Like, you know, they talked about radon in your basement and all this other crazy crap. Well, there's radiation and all kinds of stuff down under the ground that they're bringing up with all the stuff that they're doing. So we're being bombarded from all angles. And I just want to throw it out there because I know we forget sometimes when we talk about Fukushima or, you know, Hurricane Katrina or whatever. Talk about the oil wells and stuff. We've been nuked atomically and nuclearly. I'm not saying it right, but since the 50s, right? Or maybe the 40s, on a consistent basis. Because they've been doing this testing, like, on a regular schedule. So what we're getting now from Fukushima is probably just, I don't know, fortification of what has been nonstop since the 50s. So we can look at this as if, oh, well, now Fukushima is affecting us, blah, blah, blah. We've got to protect ourselves. We've been getting a steady stream since before most of us were born of nuclear waste radiation. So an atomic, I'm sure, you know, I don't know. And I want to have Helen Caldicott come on and maybe explain this to everybody, what the ramifications are of that. But when we talk about, you know, changing our DNA and everything, it's just amazing that you've taken the initiative to bring this information forward and the beneficial properties that distilled liquids have, and the information you're giving us today is so amazing that every time I talk to you, it's just mind-blowing. It's really wonderful.
Oh, thank you. It's my pleasure. It makes me feel good to have something to offer my fellow man, and I'm just tired of the misery myself, so I'm definitely been... It all started with selfish reasons in the beginning. I was looking how to make myself and my family healthy, but when I realized what I'd stumbled upon, I said, oh my gosh, we need to get the word out on this. And yeah, the pure waters handle radiation too. Radiation also, opposites attract. Radiation also has a positive charge to it. And especially people around extremely radioactive places can either pound the pure distilled water through them, or even running your own urine through you. People constantly think that when they're toxic, they can't ingest urine. And I know I even saw a video with Dr. Gabriel Cousins, who a lot of people look up to, and somebody asked him about urine therapy. And he goes, yeah, you know, we did that back in the 70s and 80s, but we've got chemtrails now. I mean, that's like saying, you know, when you're in the bubonic plague, you know, with the urine therapy, but we did that back in the 1300s, but now we've got bubonic plague, so you can't. No, urine therapy is exactly for when you are in a toxic environment. It is a way of rinsing the system out. It goes through circular, and it keeps dumping the toxins off at your liver. Your urine doesn't become toxic. The urine becomes cleaner and cleaner. And when you start running those pure water, it gives it another chance to run through and look where are the toxins hiding, and it grabs them magnetically, and it keeps dropping them off at the liver and your body, and then it sends it to all your different ejection ports, like your skin, your breath, you know, through your lungs and out through your feces. So no, it doesn't matter that we have chemtrails now. Like, chemtrails, it doesn't matter how small they've made the nanobots are still have a positive charge, and they're not going to evade water just because they made themselves tiny. I've specifically witnessed the nanobots get defeated in my own body, the itching going down completely and going away. So it is very nice that we have this magical tool with us, and even when you're in times of radiation, you can cycle your own urine through you, and you're not going to be pissing out radioactive urine. It's just going to get cleaner and cleaner.
Yeah, and I also subscribe to the belief that we are manifesting our own reality. So if that were true, and I keep saying this, I've been saying this for the past couple of years, that they're giving us the picture, and we make their reality by how we get emotionally attached to it. So as long as we are fixated and attached emotionally on any level to what's being told in the mainstream media, excuse me, through the governments and whatever, I think that's how we make their reality come to be. I don't think there's anything wrong with looking at all this information. I just think it's how we get attached to it, how we get emotionally enraged, embroiled, whatever. That, you know, they always talk about the negative. That's what feeds it. And when we don't have a response to it, then we don't feed that. But we can feed, you know, our own reality and what we want. But I totally agree with you about the urine therapy and distilled waters. When you talk about these toxins having a positive charge, is it because the distilled waters or the distilled juices have a negative charge?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So they attract and neutralize each other.
Yep. Right. Yeah. Well, it looks like the distilled water magnetically
right.
rips it out of their hiding places, but it also needs certain things, needs something to pair up with them to escort them out the body.
Okay, well, we're coming to the top of the hour, and I really didn't want to take a break unless you did, but I have this question. I was listening to your interview with Vinny, and you said water is dead. It's a dead compound. I guess basically because distilled water has no minerals or anything in it. But when I was listening to you say that, and it wasn't because I wanted to disagree with you, but I was wondering, how does Dr. Emoto transmit feelings through dead compounds? And I was wondering, is it because it's a crystalline compound and messages aren't transmitted through crystals?
Yeah, I think that would be a very simplified way of putting it. But it also, it's literally dead in that it's an inorganic compound. It's made of hydrogen and oxygen, and neither one of those are living substances. And so it's not derogatory to say that water is dead. That's just actually a scientific description of it. But it's a rare item in our world. It's the most unique item in that it's dead, but like you said, its crystalline structure makes it an antenna for what we think of and what we call life or light. And even Emoto's, I know the one picture I saw he had of distilled water, it was a perfect hexagon. And that six-sided shape, that's like the Merkaba star, the six-pointed star. They supposedly say that shape is what all other shapes can be, are found within it or come out of that shape. And so I find that fitting that a distilled water molecule in Emoto's world of looking at thing is actually just a blank hexagon, which Magenta Pixie referred to water as a blank CD that can be imprinted with anything, and people use crystals to store memory. So it's the structure of water, the shape of it, that allows it, for whatever reason, it is a channel for light. And just with our own eyes, we see that when, just like in Fat, Sick, and Nearly Dead, we see that when people start drinking pure waters, they turn from gray and lightless to golden and overflowing with light. And that's how I've done my research, and the testimonials are the backbone of my proof. This is a scientific endeavor. Just because I'm not a certified scientist or have the letters after my name or degree, this is statistical evidence, which makes it scientific. It just goes on and on and on, that people turn from gray to golden. And we don't have to have laboratory equipment to see that. We can just look at the testimonials. We can listen to the testimonials of a fellow man. We can see the videos and photos that more and more and more people are coming out of the woodwork and showing their own video and photo testimonial evidence. And that brings back to a quote from this Dr. Sidney Baker, who wrote the Detoxification and Healing book. He says, empiricists are those of us who believe what we see, and rationalists are those who see what we believe. And so rationalist is another word for what I call people who have collegeitis. They've had too much college, and they only believe what they're told. And they literally stop believing what they see. And that's all I've done, is use my own point of view, my own consciousness, and my trust in my own powers of discernment. So I guess I'm an empiricist, because I believe what I see. But it's not just one thing. I look lots of times. You know, I look thousands of times. And when I keep seeing something happen thousands of times over and over again, I don't have any problem saying that I believe it, because I've seen it.
Absolutely. And if we trust it in the scientific method, well, then this surpasses the test.
It does.
We repeat it multiple times and we get the same results. People are cured. People are healed. I just want to say I smashed my finger in a log splitter Saturday, a week ago Saturday. Well,
listen.
I had gloves on, and when I felt my finger, I thought I was losing it. I really did. I thought I had passed the point of no return, and I guess I screamed or something. My brother-in-law, who was operating the handle, heard me and stopped it and reversed it. And I got my finger out, and the first thing I said was, nothing touches. and I just like kind of shook it, and within like 30 seconds I could move it. So then I knew it wasn't broken.
Wow.
And it's really swollen. It's still swollen now. But I soaked it for the first 3 days in urine. I had a rag, and I dipped it in a glass and wrapped it in a bag and fell asleep like that. So it wouldn't fall off. But the second night it fell off.
Wow.
Because I was sleeping like a wobble. I don't know what would happen, or it untied. And the third night I tied it a little bit tighter. I even put a hairband around it to try to keep it. But I should have saved the urine from the first night, because I think it would have been more medicinally perfect, because it was increasing in strength and in the alkalinity. But the rag I didn't change. I kept the same rag. But I was just dipping it in fresh urine.
That's fine.
And I think those 3 days, I have no black and blue, but I stopped. I should have kept doing it. I'm starting to get some feeling in the tip, and there was no feeling down the whole, like, the center from the tip to the first knuckle. It's still swollen. I mean, you can see. And I'm starting to get a little black and bluishness on the right side of the nail, just on the very edge there. But considering what the possibilities could have been,
yeah.
I think I'm really fortunate. But, you know, it was just amazing that I have this little black mark, and I don't know what that's. I guess I broke a blood vessel or broke the skin when it squeezed it, whatever. So it's healing. It's getting itchy, so I know it's healing. So I should probably soak it some more, but it was really hot when I did it, and we put ice on it, and the ice was painful. I couldn't put the ice on it at all. Mm-hmm. But when I soaked it with the urine, it you know, it was just perfect. And I went to work the next day. So if that has any bearing on it, you know, maybe my thinking, the way I thought about the whole thing. And I tried to imagine I didn't get hurt, but it didn't quite work that way. But I haven't had any pain with this at all.
Wow, that's great.
Well, I probably smashed the nerves, but that's another story.
But wrapping it for 3 days in urine, that's just awesome. That's,
yeah, I think that's that
to say that you don't have any black and blue after getting your thumb caught in a log splitter. What a testimonial.
Yes.
Good for you.
I probably should have took a picture the first day, because it really wasn't black and blue, but you could tell, like, it, you know, it was swollen. It was really swollen and red. But it's like, nobody would know unless I told them. And then you saw the little, it's a tiny little black, like, scratch. I hope it's black and blue, not black like something else. But it's my finger seems to be, starting to get the sensation in the tip, which I didn't have. So it's, I'm not even worried about it. I just kind of, but I think I should soak it some more. Like I said, I soaked my feet this morning, and I'm going to do it tonight before I go to bed, because I think it was a wonderful suggestion. I wish I hadn't taken it sooner. And I also did something that maybe you can explain a little better, pulling, urine pulling this morning. I really don't ever want to go to a dentist again.
Okay.
I've already lost about 6 teeth, one from a bridge that I had put in because I lost a tooth when I was pregnant. And I know it was a direct result from drug use. But not when I was pregnant, but before, and the baby, I guess, took the rest of whatever. But I've lost so many teeth that it's almost getting to where it's tenuous on chewing, because they're back teeth, and I really don't want to lose anymore. And I do believe you can grow your own teeth back, but maybe not for another 50 years. Is that how it works? But I like to keep the ones I have.
Well, all the testimonies I've seen of people growing their teeth back, they weren't even practicing urine therapy. They were just people that grew up in very healthy environments. They ate mainly fruit their whole lives. They ate very little, also, was the common theme in general. They never had pasteurized milk. If they had milk, it was only ever raw. But it looks like, on average, we get a new set of teeth every 100 years. But I would not be surprised if, with the way that we're in such a toxic environment and the way that we're all rebounding and by scrambling, I mean, that's, I wouldn't be talking about this stuff if I hadn't been trying to figure out how to protect my family. It forced me to find all these answers, but the answers we've come up with, like urine therapy, are incredibly powerful. I wouldn't be surprised if people grow teeth back before they get to 100. The body recognizes poisons, and it's, as Gary Ward nicely pointed out, which I hadn't heard before in his audio tapes, Personal Pharmacy, that when people begin practicing urine therapy, those that have mercury fillings, that those teeth themselves start to become loose, as though the body is trying to say, look, if you're not going to get this lump of mercury removed by a holistic dentist, I'm just going to eject the whole tooth, because the body knows what it does and doesn't want in itself. And when you give it the proper tools to clean house, it'll even start pushing out teeth that got mercury inside them. But oil, urine pulling, that's people kind of came from people doing oil pulling, which is that when you take some living oils like coconut oil, it's got a negative electrical charge because it's living, and you swish it in your mouth for 10 or 20 minutes, and it'll be magnetically attracted to all the poisons that are in your mouth, and they come out of your gums, and really helps to detox the head. You can do the same thing with urine. One of the rules with oil pulling is you're supposed to spit out the oil afterwards, because it'll be loaded with toxins. And that would probably make sense too. Whenever I do urine swishing, I tend to spit it out after 10 minutes. But it's a magnetic liquid vacuuming of your whole mouth area. And that's one of the most minimal things you can do if you're just interested in urine therapy, and to get a huge daily benefit, is the holding of it in your mouth for 10 minutes does a couple of things. In regards to the teeth, one is said you need to hold it for 10 minutes to allow it to soak deeply into the gums to come at the teeth from the backside, from the root end of it. Or obviously, when you put it in your mouth, your teeth and the part of your teeth that are exposed, they get the immediate benefits. But you need to let it soak into your gums so it can get into the nerve and root area of your tooth. And that really provides amazing, quick detox of the teeth. When I was in Ecuador, one gentleman there that I helped oversee a fast with, his teeth were black from having had lung cancer and having gone through chemo and radiation. They weren't solid black. It was like they had black interior cores to them. There was this black kind of color inside of them. And he wasn't 3 days through, 3 days into the 5-day fast, the black was gone. And I had encouraged him to swish with urine 3 times a day for 10 minutes at a time. And just by doing that, just within 3 days, something he'd had for at least a decade, black teeth, that all that went away. The other, probably even more important aspect of holding urine in your mouth for 10 minutes is that the lymph nodes under your tongue get to study what's in your urine, and your urine contains antigens, which are little dots or pieces of information about what's wrong with you. You've got the flu or cancer or H1N1 virus, doesn't matter. There'll be antigens of that in your urine, and when you hold it under your tongue in your mouth for 10 minutes, the two lymph nodes under your tongue study the antigens and they start producing the correct antibody. So it's literally is the vaccination system. And you could do that, if you do that every morning with even just 10 drops, you can't really do swishing with 10 drops, but you can just hold those 10 drops onto your tongue and allow your lymph nodes to study what's in the urine. And it's literally like going to the doctor and getting a polio vaccine or something. If you had polio, you don't have to get the poisonous shots to deal with it. Your own urine will give you the information that you need. And that's how vaccines work anyways. They're giving you dead or beat up, destroyed cells of, say, polio. And since they're dead and been beat up, they're not harmful to you. They won't give you polio. But your body can study it and say, ah, okay, now I know how to deal with this creature. And that's what's in your urine. Those antigens are the information of the creature or the poison that's bothering you. And then the body starts making the correct antidote. And, of course, we always talked about that you don't have to worry about snake and spider bites anymore because the same system. If you get bit by a snake, whatever type of snake it is, it doesn't matter if it's a black mamba or coral snake, any of the most poisonous snakes in the world, still their antigens of their venom is going to be in your urine seconds after you get bit, and all you have to do is pee out a little bit and hold it under your tongue, and you won't die. But yes, urine pulling is very, very healthy for the teeth and the gums and the immune system in numerous ways.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I'd like to talk about Santos Bonacci.
Are you sure you really want to? I heard what you had to say. I totally agree.
Yeah.
This is just amazing.
I have to talk about
the metamorphosis he made. Oh my God.
Yeah. I don't really want to. I don't want to call him out, but he's... Not only is he killing himself, but he's encouraging other people to take these cell salts. And I said he's adding sea salt to his water in the Vinnie Eastwood interview. But more correctly, what you can see him do in some of his talks in his video, he holds up a bottle of either concentrates or alcatrace drops. They're alkaline mineral drops. But what it really is it's seawater. Seawater is 75% sodium, and that's a huge amount of sodium. When people try to argue about salt, they say, yeah, but the human blood is made up from the same exact ingredients of ocean water. Yeah, except we're not 75% sodium. But anyways, all minerals in the ocean are completely dead. That is a known scientific fact, that those are inorganic minerals. And Santos has been going around either in his public talks and or behind the scenes afterwards chatting with people, because many people have written to me to tell me about this, that he's saying that I'm wrong about the body's ability to assimilate inorganic minerals. And I guess that's his way of justifying taking cell salt and sea salt because he's recognizing that these are inorganic minerals. But that's not, I didn't say, that's a known scientific fact that we can't ingest and assimilate inorganic. Yes, you might be able to eat them and they'll go physically inside you, but they don't ever become a part of your living system in your body. They only become part of your death. They only clog you up and poison you and require your body's precious living organic stores to be used up to pair up and to counter these poisons. And so what these concentrates or alkatrace drops are, is it's seawater that's had the sodium removed, and it's just the, it's all the other minerals, the 88 or the 92 quote-unquote essential minerals that are in there. And yes, they're essential, but you need the living versions of them. And I know he's also about the 12 salts of salvation. There's this book that he's all about. But they have to be living. You can't take inorganic salts in you. It's totally deadly. And now we have an undistilled water testimonial in Santos Bonacci, in that he puts these concentrated mineral drops, and I've heard the likes of David Wolfe, Daniel Vitalis, Gabriel Cousins, all these supposed leaders of the alternative health movement are all telling people to remineralize their water, even if they're in favor of distilled water, which Dr. Gabriel Cousins said he uses distilled water, but then he adds drops to it. To rebuild, and somehow they're all using this magic number of 150 parts per million. I've heard multiple ones that say you want to bring it up to, and I specifically heard Cousins say it, you want to add drops and bring your water up to 150 parts per million. Now, in the distilled waters world, we don't want water that's clogged up with garbage. We want water that's at zero parts per million, so that has the ability to vacuum garbage out of your system. If your water already has garbage in it, it's going to give you garbage and not have the room to vacuum out the garbage you already have inside you, which is what you want it to do. So in Santos, we see a man that 2 years ago had beautiful skin, radiant, moist sheen to his skin, and beautiful black hair. And he's gone from that to somebody who looks like he's dying. He's shriveling away and become incredibly gray-haired. And that doesn't happen at all when people follow the distilled waters correctly and they don't undistill their water before they drink it by adding poison to it. So he's adding poison to his water and taking cell salt pills, two sources of poison, and he's blatantly showing us. I don't know if he's like trying to sacrifice himself and show us this is what not to do. Because on the other end of the spectrum, we got Greg Prescott going from gray-haired to golden. And he just gets more and more wild. The time goes on. You keep looking at Greg Prescott's Facebook photos. It's literally like we've been watering a plant that was starting to wilt away. He's just blossoming to his life. His hair just gets crazier and crazier. And Santos is doing the opposite. Santos looks like somebody who is being poisoned and is dying while encouraging other people to take these cell salts. So I loved Santos, and I loved the interviews that I did with him. They were great, and they inspired a lot of people. And he knows all this knowledge, but somehow he got, I don't know what he's doing. I don't know how he got steered off course and dropped all this and can't look in the mirror and see what's happening. And it's been so, and the reason I have to talk about it is because people keep writing me, and nobody seems to have the nerve to want to confront him live on the air about this. And he never asked me. He knew my position, but he started going around telling people, mentioning me, and that I was wrong. And I'm forced to say something because he's killing people by, now he's killing himself, but if you encourage other people to take cell salts and people look up to you because you're going around giving talks about astrotheology, and people love to come hear you, and he's given a worldwide tour, and people were kind of asking him, you know, Santos, what's wrong? You don't look so hot. What's going on? He was complaining that it was the traveling. But that's not true either. People that practice the distilled water number knowledge have tons of energy. They report having more energy than they've ever had in their life. It's not because he's traveling or because he's going to these different places and he's tired and he's stressed. That doesn't happen when you practice the distilled water's knowledge correctly. You have you have more energy than anybody else does, and you start to look beautiful and filled out, and your skin doesn't wrinkle, and you got a golden glow to you. And that Santos is going the other direction, and it's blatantly obvious. And I asked on the Vinny show for a public campaign to get people to wake him up, because he doesn't seem to want to listen to anybody about it. I don't know if nobody's ever even had the balls to actually say anything to him. I know people have said, geez, you're not looking good, because it's stirred conversations, which is forced him to mutter responses like, oh, I'm just tired, it's just all this traveling. But no, dude, Santos, you're killing yourself. Look in the mirror. You are not practicing alchemy. You are not going from gray to golden. You are going from golden to gray, and you need to stop it. Otherwise, you're gonna take it right to the grave. You need to stop adding poison to your water.
Well, it's and fair I don't, to I don't, say he's not practicing distilled liquids at all. Distilled waters. He's
right. He's practicing undistilled water.
Normal diet.
I think what will really blow people away the most, and I don't think people realize this, Santos and I are only 7 years apart in age. You can look at a picture of him right now, and you can see me a week ago. You can see the Vinnie Eastwood interview of me. I'm starting to get golden streaks in my hair, not starting to get gray hair. And he was born in 63, and I was born in 70. And, you know, my wife Susie's 55. She's born in 58. She's 5 years older than him. And he looks like he's 30 years older than her. And he didn't used to. Just 2 years ago, you could see the man looking beautiful. And so this would be awesome if he would recognize this, stop poisoning himself, and actually get back on distilled waters, stop taking salt pills, and then reverse himself. Then he could go from gray to golden. You know, Greg Prescott was turning gray and needed to go back up to golden. But Santos was already golden. He had beautiful health. But now he's gone from golden to gray. And what a triumph it would be if we can get everybody to get through to him and say, Santos, yeah, man, we love you. We love your astrotheology. But you're wrong about the salts. This whole book about the 12 salts of salvation. I'm all for it, dude. I'm all for the salts of salvation and that we have these salts in our blood and these salts are in the ocean, but they have to be the living versions of them. You need to get these salts from fruits and vegetables. Please.
Well, I'm posting a picture of before and after Santos on the chat box. And okay. It is such a drastic, I mean, I don't know how many years difference these are. Maybe they're only 5, 10 years, I'm not sure. Who is he? She wants to know who is he. Angel, Santos Bonacci is a musician. Is he an author? He's a lecturer on astrotheology. He's very much promotes some of the information that we share that has to do with not just astrology, but the Bible, and how the Bible is more a book about the heavens, astro theology, than it is about human beings, religion of Jesus Christ, and, you know, the stories that we've been told. And the big proponent of that is Jordan Maxwell, if you're familiar with him. But Santos has gotten into it sort of like a religion, I guess you would say. He's been very instrumental in promoting astrotheology for people to understand a lot more about our reality. And also, he's been instrumental in helping me find an individual called Bill Donahue, who's a preacher in Forked River, New Jersey, who preaches like a preacher, like a regular religious Sunday service, but he preaches on astrotheology, and he gives a sermon, and he talks about the truth of what the Bible's really trying to tell us about ourselves and our life and how it relates to the universe. And it's real practical, and I try to play him as much as possible when I'm just messing around on air.
Well, yeah, which
that's
is
a huge,
you know,
transformation. She's looking at the pictures of him. Well, maybe right, that first picture is a little bit older than what we're talking about. I'm going to try to find the one where he's interviewing Andrew. That would be a more legitimate.
Yeah, and, you know, it really doesn't matter that much. Even if you're finding a picture 10 years ago, if he were practicing the Stillwater's knowledge properly, he would look the same, if not younger, than he did 10 years ago. Now he looks 40. He looks like he's, you know, getting into the 70s or 80s, you know?
We
it looks
have
terrible.
The picture of Greg. I'm posting the before and after. There's a shot of them side by side.
Yeah, and yeah, because Greg made that up and made a post about what, and that happened to Greg in just 90 days.
Yeah.
You can look at some of Greg's more current Facebook profile pictures, and it just gets even funnier. Something else that I need to address about Santos, this has really bothered me, is his promotion of Kangen water. And he had Karen Ann McDonald on his show, who goes around giving talks and promoting and is a sales lady for the multi-level marketing scheme of $4,000 Kangen machines. These alkalizing machines, which are actually produce deadly water. And I specifically spent at least a half an hour during one of my three talks with Santos, destroying alkalizing machines and Kangen machines and talking about how poisonous they are.
And a Kangen machine, just tell me what it is, because it comes up a lot. Is it just an alkaline machine, but it's more expensive model? Is that what it is?
Yes, but...
Well, I interviewed a guy who, he's taken that and he's adding it with monatomic gold.
God.
And he's talking to higher realms in the fifth dimension or something. And I think it's, if there's anything satanic, I think this is pretty close to it.
Well, it's straight up,
everything is not meant for us to be a part of that, but anyway, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, it produces straight up poison. There's nothing good about alkalizing machines, and there's not just the Kangen brand, there's a whole bunch of them, but they're all expensive and they all produce alkaline water. And this is a complete, this is opposite land. This is you don't want alkaline water. Alkaline water means it's deadly. It means it's got burnt fuels in it. It's got ash, otherwise known as alkalis. And Kangen machines, if you use tap water in that, the only actual cleaning of the water in a Kangen machine is a carbon filter. That's it. Okay? Then it goes to the next chamber, which is what the thing is really all about, which is to alkalize it. it does this by a...
Right?
No, well, that's what I thought at first. And there's a mistake in the Lisa Harris interview. Somebody had just mentioned alkalizing machines, Kangen machines, to me before the Lisa Harris interview. And I hadn't had a time to look into them yet. But people were talking about all these miracle healing reactions that people were having after drinking this water. And I incorrectly assumed, maybe it's one of those, maybe the machine is adding drops to it. So hear me talk about Kangen machines adding drops to it. But it doesn't do that at all. I just assume that's how they're, which is still deadly, just what's killing Santos. They add alkali, trying to alkalize the water by adding dead matter to it, which is what it does. Alkalinity, alkaline, alkalize, ash, that's dead matter. When you burn a piece of wood, you get ash, has what's in it known as alkalis. You don't ever feel like eating ash. The energy comes from living things are acidic. And when you eat them, they have fuel to burn. And it's just like when you burn a piece of wood, that energy, potential energy that's in the piece of wood, the spent fuel residue is called ash or alkalis. And so people are adding dead matter. They're adding ash to their water, these concentrate drops. It's all dead matter. And yes, it makes it alkaline because it's dead. And Kangen machines... They work in all alkalizing machines. They work by method of electrolysis. Enlysis means to break apart in Latin or Greek. And so electrolysis means to break apart with electricity. It is literally frying the water. And one of the things that they use to promote alkaline, this Kangen water, is that it... The machine, the process, makes smaller, tighter water molecules. But it is a complete half-truth, kind of lie thing. Yes, it makes quote-unquote smaller water molecules because it blows the molecules apart into pieces. It's not that it organizes it and structures it and makes it a tighter H2O. It literally separates an H off of the H2O. And you're left with H and HO. And HO is called hydroxide. That water, that machine does not put out H2O. That machine does not put out water. It puts out hydroxide. Ask any biochemist if it's a good idea for a human to ingest hydroxide. They'll slap you silly. They say, no. Bad monkey. That's a poison. And in Japan, very bad monkey. In Japan, Kangen water is not given to people by doctors to drink in volume. It is only ever given to people 1 ounce at a time in a shot glass because it's poisonous. And they specifically give it to chemo and radiation patients because the ingestion of that poisonous liquid, this back to the method of poisonous stimulation, it forces the body to go into emergency detox mode, and because of that thrust, that push to eject the hydroxide, because it's poisonous, some radiation and chemotherapy poisons also get pushed out. So they give it to people on purpose, knowing that it's poisonous, knowing that it'll stimulate a detox reaction because it's poisonous, to help them eject some of their radiation. So it's like fighting fire with fire, right? But if you don't have a fire, there's no reason to consume fire or poison. And so that's one way that they're confusing people and trying to say it makes a smaller water molecule. It's not water, as one doctor put, it's not water at all, and he calls it not water because it's an accurate title. It looks like water because it's made of hydrogen oxide. It's still a clear liquid, but it is not H2O, it's HO. Totally different animal, okay? This stuff is poisonous off the charts, and I know Dr. Robert Morse testifies all the time to dealing with victims who come to him from a couple of years on these machines. So people report these amazing healing reactions to drinking the Kangen water, and that, again, they don't realize that what they're talking about is because it's poisonous. Yes, in the beginning, people start ejecting poisons because they're forcing their body to do this. And it can take 6 months to 3, 4, 5 years maybe. But what happens is people start to get electrically skitzed out. They start to get weird and freaky. And I even had an old lady call into my show, and she just couldn't quite find the words to put for what the Kangen water was doing to her. She just said, I started to feel weird. I think she even said something like, I got skitzed out or just strange. And what is going on is the daily consumption of mass volumes of that poison puts your immune system under tremendous stress. And remember, I said early on that Dr. Sidney Baker said that's the most expensive process in your body is the immune system and the detoxing. And so this forces your body to detox constantly massive amounts of poison, and it starts to give out after a few years. It just can't handle it, and people's bodies start to break down in all kinds of incredible, horrifying ways. And I even saw a testimonial from an ex-Kangen salesman saying, even though I kept telling my family, you're getting healthier and healthier and healthier because this water is so awesome for you because I'm reading all the materials and I'm giving you all of the key points that you're supposed to say to sell this machine and its multi-level marketing scheme. But yet my family just kept getting sicker and sicker and sicker. And finally I had to face the reality that it wasn't true. And he stopped being a Kangen salesman and stopped from pushing this poison on his family. Okay, so I went through all of that with Santos Bonacci and explained how deadly this water is. And then about 6 months ago, I think it was on American Freedom Radio, Santos had Karen Ann McDonald on his show and just let her run rampant about Kangen water. And even when it came down to go to break and commercial break and come back, he's like, all right, we'll be right back with more Kangen water. And it was like, you know, being cool and fun and exciting with it. Never once countering this person who was promoting death. Even though I had given him a complete lesson about it. So I wrote to him because I first found out about it because people were writing me. They're going, Andrew, what is wrong with Santos? Why is he having this woman on promoting this deadly water? And so I wrote to him, I said, Santos, and in capital letters, I said, you got to correct that stuff. I said, that's deadly information. What are you doing? And he wrote back to me and said, I let my guests say what they want to. And I was like, really? Even when it's deadly? But I was so blown away that I didn't say anything. I just wrote back to him and said, okay, dude, I guess it's your show. You can do what you want. And he gave me a further one-liner response back, was that, yeah, when I had you on, I even got death threats. None of that, even if that's true, which I don't doubt it.
I don't mean to laugh, but yeah.
That's got zero justification for spreading death knowledge, for letting somebody talk about a poisonous fluid and not saying something.
But you're in backwards land. What do you expect?
Yeah, but I don't expect that of somebody who I thought was promoting the truth.
But he's promoting his own truth. He really
is. I guess. Well, okay, so that means part of his own truth is deadly, and now we can just look at him and see his own truth is killing him.
Right.
And to say that, you know, I didn't ask him this because I was just so blown away, I just let it go, but really? You just let your guests say what you want? So you mean that if I came on your show and completely said exact opposite truth and lies about astrotheology, you would just let me go on about it? You wouldn't correct me at all?
What did he say?
Well, no, I didn't say, I never asked him that. I just left it alone because he was saying that's his show and he just lets his guests do what they want. But of course, that's the obvious immediate thought. Like, no, really? You just let people say whatever they want, even if it's complete lies? And so the example for him would be, would you let somebody spew complete false lies about your astrotheology science? No, he'd destroy them. He'd rip them apart and say, no, you're wrong about this because for this, you know, he pointed, but he did not do that in the slightest bit when he had Karen Ann McDonald on his show. Now, to really pull this into a point and to show you how blatantly poisonous alkaline water is and water out of Kangen alkalizing machines. Karen Ann McDonald, anybody can find this, just find the Santos Bonacci Karen Ann McDonald interview, and I think it's about 30 minutes in when she puts down distilled water, puts down reverse osmosis water, and what she gives as a proof to show that Kangen alkalized water is good for you? She says, quote, and yeah, a lot of times when people drink Kangen water, their lips start to tingle.
Oh, and yeah, I heard this, that. Oh, my God, yeah.
Yeah, she says it in an excited voice and just, oh, wow, it's such a wonderful thing. People, and even their lips start to tingle. Okay, everybody, stop what you're doing and get on the Google machine and type in lips tingling. You will not find anything good about that. Lips tingling throws up massive red flags. All the lights come up on the board, and it nothing but pure warnings about poison and allergic response. Lips tingling is a sign that you are being poisoned. And these people are so misinformed that they're actually going around stating that the poisonous symptoms are something to be happy about. And it's a sign of joy. This is total madness. And I put out a public demand for people to ask Santos about this. Say, what are you doing? Why are you promoting death? Are you serious? We're in the truth movement and you just let people go off about deadly poisons and then say, Kangen water, we'll be right back. Really? I don't think so. I think there needs to be a major correction coming out of Santos Bonacci's mouth on numerous fronts.
And this also, you need to understand, too, that he may be possessed by the effects of what he's doing. I mean, whatever he's putting into his body, these salts, to whatever, what did you call them, the 12
salts and stuff. There's a book called that. And
yeah, so he believes that on the month you were born, there's a certain salt dedicated to that, and you might be deficient in it. That's uh-huh. the basis of it. And that you need to add that to your diet. And he studied this, and he believes that this is true. Unfortunately, he doesn't see the effects of his own research on himself. I'd like to have him on as an interview. I would certainly ask him. I mean, I wouldn't have no problem with that. I'd have you on too in the background. That'd be pretty cool. But
well, I'd be willing to do a show with him. I don't know if he'll want to now, but there's something going on. Something not right with what's coming out of that boy's mouth lately.
But it's also instructive to know that you call this what, backwards land or
opposite
backwards
land.
World, opposite world. Okay, there's two paths, you know, and there's going to be miscommunication. We're not going to be able to talk to each other even. So we're becoming more and more aware of this. I want to tell you, 7 years ago when I was here living with my sister, I did not have the relationship that I have today. So for whatever reason, I've been directed in this, and I've had dreams about this. I've had apocalyptic dreams about walking to her house with my family. I don't know what that has to do with anything, but to be here now with her and be able to communicate with her and to say, I've been able to say almost everything. I mean, we talked about our past. She's had horrible resentments of me from childhood. We've been able to talk about and for her to invite me to her home and have this loving environment that we have there here. It's just unbelievable. So I think, I don't want to say closing of the ranks, but I think it's a time when people can become aware of, like, you know, We're giving out the information and we're trying to put it out and give it to everybody, but there's some people that don't really want to listen. And my guest for Sunday was supposed to be Alfred Labermont Weber, and he made a comment to me 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago, at the first Free Your Mind conference in Philadelphia. And he said, I couldn't understand why we want to try to make people understand what's happening in the world and why things are the way they are, but it doesn't seem like anybody's listening. And he kind of smiled and said, that's because that's the way they want it. In other words, he was trying to let me know that they have such a control on what is really happening. The fact that you and I and people like us are even aware of this information is like we've, in the Matrix, we've broken the connection somehow. We've gotten out of the Matrix. I wouldn't say that we're totally out of it, but for some reason, we're not in that control system the way most people are.
Water is the way out of the Matrix.
Right.
That's what the matter is. The matrix is the matter. Water is the lubricant between dimensions. All light in this universe comes here through water. All matter is condensed light. The matrix is matter. The way out of the matter is through the water. That's how we got here, and that's the way back out. I'd like to talk about two incredible movies that have come to my attention as being vast stores of knowledge, but hidden in plain sight. One is The Neverending Story, and the other one is a more recent movie called Legend of the Guardians. It's a movie about owls, of all things.
I saw that.
And I got it because I thought, oh, that'd be fun to watch a pretty movie of pretty pictures of birds. And whoa, my jaw dropped when that movie started. The first thing that they start out with is a child kidnapping ring. Right. The baby owls fell out of their tree, and these scary looking owls come by and swoop them up, and for some reason these owls don't ever seem to even think to look in the tree above them right where they were. You know, if you found a child lost in the street, you might bang on the doors on the surrounding houses, hey, is this your kid, before you decide to steal it to an orphanage. Which is what they do. They take these kids away and put them into a work slave camp. That's weird. And there's a snake that raised the baby owls, and the snake is purple, and you know the Ouroboros is the snake, symbol of the snake eating its tail? Mm-hmm. Well, this snake is purple, and its name, I kid you not, is Mrs. P.
Right, and I this remember, is the snake, coming back, yep.
The snake that raised the babies. We're all the Ouroboros as a baby in the womb. We all were a snake eating its own tail.
Oh my God. We produced
the urine, and we drank ourselves. We consume ourselves, and we grow in the womb. And that's the most revered symbol. It's one of the oldest symbols on the whole planet, is the symbol of the snake eating its tail in a circular pattern. And that's what you do when you pee in a glass and you drink it. You're consuming yourself. And so they got a purple snake called Mrs. P raising babies in this movie.
Right.
Okay? Now, the hero character's name is, the owl, is called Soren. Soren. Okay? So hold that in your mind for a second. And realize that urine is called urine. And this baby owl's name is called Soren. Now hold that in your mind. Let's go over to the movie The Neverending Story, which was based on a book written over 100 years ago, I believe called The Water of Life, if I remember correctly. And that's what The Neverending Story is based off. And now it's called The Neverending Story. The snake, the symbol of the snake eating its tail is a round and round thing. It's a never-ending story, okay? Now, I got that right there. Okay. In the never-ending story, there is a magical necklace that is called the Orin. And it's spelled A-U-R-Y-N. And the hero character's name in The Legend of the Guardian is called Soren. And the medallion in Neverending Story is called Orin. And the medallion is a double Ouroboros. It's two snakes eating their tails in like a figure eight pattern. And the original book, Orin, always printed in capital letters, is mentioned 22 times. And of course, we know that in the Bible, the water of life refers to urine, is mentioned 55 times. The whole movie is about urine therapy and the Ouroboros. And it's incredible, the quotes that are in that movie about what the Orin amulet will do to the wearer, the amount of protections it will give. It's talking all about urine. But I think I want to announce that I figured out that the actual, if we did have the real English word for urine, it wouldn't be urine, it would be Orin. And I've said in my talks many times that nobody likes to say the word urine, and that it's a corrupt word. It's just like penis and vagina are uncomfortable to say in English. They're not, when you listen to just the sounds, they're not nice sounds. And we even had the vagina monologues play written about how uncomfortable it is to say the word. And the English language is a corrupt language meant to keep us low vibrating. It's full of low vibrating, correct words. Even your intent may be there. Your sound is so important. The sounds you make in the beginning was the word, and that's sound. And urine sounds like a car that won't start. It's like a urine, urine, right? It's not a nice word. And I understand now that urine is the word for the water of life for a slave. And the sound is a very low vibrating sound, and that's on purpose. When you start getting into the or sound, it makes a lot more sense. And there are so many words that have the or sound, which are beautiful, wonderful things. And things that have the sound tend to be things you're not really interested, like dirt and turd. And even the name for our planet is Earth. But that's the name for a slave. That's not the original name of our planet. That's the name for when it became a slave planet, is Earth. And the original first city on the Earth that we know about in the Sumerian history was called Ur. So it's got, and that's the first slave city, right? But when it comes to Or, and like Orin, and the lead character's name Sorin, and the medallion Orin, and in Spanish, urine therapy is not called urine therapy. It's called orinoterapia, Orin. So the Or sound, your light body, is called an aura. Gold is the elemental symbol for it, is AU. The Hebrew word for light is or, O-R. Gold in Spanish is called oro. The agency or medium of a god is called an oracle. In Greek, to urinate means or, is said orin. To urinate, orin. And oron is urine in Greek. And so in all these other languages, urine is referred to as orin. And Wilhelm Reich's light force was called orgon. A fruit garden, a beautiful, it's called an orchard. One of the most lovely flowers is called an orchid. To orchestrate, to come into order. Now, what all this is pointing at, and we have organic minerals. It's when things become organized, that or whatever that is, that is a good thing. And it's prevalent in the words that have ore in them. And you don't want inorganic minerals. So that means they're unorganized and they can't hold light. You want organic minerals because they're organized and they hold light. And when you orchestrate something, when you put it into order, or when you organize things, see, all these things with org are all these wonderful things. We have an orgasm, right? We have an organism. Orinoterapia is in Spanish. And the Ouroboros. And there's even an alternate spelling of Ouroboros where there's no U in the beginning. It's just O-R-O. And I found out that Boros in Hungarian is the nickname for a heavy drinker. So we got an Ouroboros, a heavy drinker of Ouro, of light. And I'm trying to say that water, pure water, channels light. And that's what all these words are showing you, that light comes through water and it organizes things. And that's why it's called the Ouroboros. That's why it's called orinoterapia. That's why it's called your aura. And that's why the medallion is called the Orin. And it's spelled with an A-U, just like your aura. It's because these are the words and the sounds to describe, to properly sound, water that channels light, the water of life. And so I believe that the proper way to talk about urine in English is not urine, it's orin. I'm going to see if I can do that for now, but I really want to announce that to the world and let people know. Try to not say urine anymore. It's a purposely low vibrating sound. It's orin. That is what English is, and it's light water. It's a liquid that channels light.
How do you want to spell that?
O-R-I-N.
O-R-I-N, okay.
Yeah, or even a nice way. I mean, I really like the never-ending story. It's spelled A-U-R-Y-N. And so it's mixing the word aura with orin. And, you know, that's a word for gold, ore, and oro, things that are shiny. It just all comes back around the sound. Isn't that nice?
Yep. Well, we just have a few more minutes. Do you want to give your website again?
Yeah, it's andrewnortonweber.com, and where you can see my sculptures there. And that's my personal website, and where I'm collecting all the true free water knowledge. I'm doing it both sites, but the one that's just about water is called AquariusTheWaterBearer.com, spelled just like the constellation. And I have a water library there now, where I'm trying to collect PDFs and of all the books that I have. And the Doctors and Experts link is there, and there's 500 testimonials there. It's a great resource of information. It's free. There's no subscription rate. This knowledge should be everybody's birthright, and I hope for everybody to share it with everybody that they know
and love. Absolutely. And I also like to thank everybody on the chat who gave their wonderful comments, for Angel and Kev, and thank Awake and Shaziz for allowing us to broadcast this wonderful interview with Andrew Norton Weber, AquariusTheWaterBearer.com. And AndrewNortonWeber.com, and he's available on Facebook. Thank you, Andrew. As always, it's been an absolutely enlightening 2 hours, and I just learned so much every time I listen to you, whether it's on your other interviews or speaking to you directly. It's just amazing. Your wealth of knowledge just continues to increase, and you're just providing the world with a wonderful resource, and I appreciate everything you're doing, and good luck on your book.
Thanks, Chrissy.
And give our love to Susie.
You got it.
And everybody at Aquarius the Water Bearer, the new web page on the Facebook, and I will be talking to you soon.
Okay, thanks so much for having me on and giving me this opportunity to speak.
Oh, thank you for doing this wonderful work, service of love for humanity. It's amazing. You're an amazing man.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thank you, Andrew. The world is a better place because you're doing what you're doing.
Oh, thank you very much. It makes me feel good.
Thank you. Thank you for making us feel better. Thank you for healing us.
We need it.
Absolutely.
It's time to have a party on this planet. Enough of the misery.
Absolutely. And Angel says thank you. Wonderful.
Thank you, Angel.
And Kevin, wherever you are. All right. So that's it for today. August 24th. This is a beautiful Thursday. You can go soak your feet or do whatever you want to do. Pull your teeth and drink your Auryn. A-R-Y. What is it? A-U-R-Y-I-N? A-U-R-Y-I-N?
Yeah, or you can do it O-R-I-N.
Auryn. Well, thank you, yeah. Andrew. Thank you for teaching us so many wonderful things today. And we'll be talking to you.
All right.
Have a wonderful
Take
day.
Care. You
Bye.
Too.
Bye.
You're listening to Awake Radio. Straight talk to the awake and aware.
This is what my urine looks like this morning. It's March 6th, about 9 o'clock in the morning. And this is the lightest it's ever been. And I'm trying to figure out why it is so light. It's, you know, halfway clear to water. And I don't understand that. Because usually it's more yellow, but this is clearly, let's see, let me put it up against the sky. Does that help? Yeah, there's, but it's nearly clear, and it has almost no taste, so that may be good. I don't know. It depends on what I guess I had yesterday. I had a lot of blueberries yesterday. I don't know why that would... And I had a lot of carrot juice, 3 glasses of carrot juice yesterday. So, okay. That's the story. And this is the oldest known book in the world. This is the book, The Water of Auspiciousness. And it was published about 5 or 6 thousand years ago on bamboo strips held together by goat twine. And it's basically a book on fasting. It says, Shiva speaks, O Parvati, those who practice this method can enjoy the fruits of their meditation and method. The Shivimbu is to be drunk from pots made of gold, earthen. The followers of this therapy should avoid pungent ingredients in their meals, not overexert themselves. Follow a balanced, light diet. Sleep on the ground. Control the senses. Such a trained person gets up early in the morning when the night has passed. Faces east and passes Shivimbu. Well, it's kind of hard to not do that in the morning because usually my bladder's full. So this is a very funny book written about urine therapy 5,000 years ago. And after 5 months, you will be bestowed with divine eyesight. Let me tell you, at 70, my eyesight is quite good. 7 years of use helps the follower capable of conquering his ego. Well, that's interesting. Soon he will be able to listen to the movement of his organs. Yep, I can do that. So it's you get a copy of this from the book, The Golden Fountain. and I highly recommend it as, well, it's the oldest known book in the world, so it's useful that way.